So, very much welcome to the end of the Prologue Basics course and our special guest lecture with SWI Prologue's lead maintainer, Jan Weilemacher. I think Jan needs little introduction to all of you. So I think I'll just let Jan go here.
All right, thank you, Anne. So this will be kind of overview of how to deal with data in Prologue. It will not be a lot of coding. There will be not actually no code in there. It will be mostly kind of overview about what kind of things have been done with Prologue to deal with larger amount of data. So I'll now try to share my screen. And by the way, if anyone wants to break in and start some discussion and change the entire lecture into some other direction, that's all fine. So just break in and we can have discussions as much as you like. So first try to share my screen. And I knew how to do that, but at the moment, where is this thing? Present, that's it. A window, and then this one, share. Yes, can you see the slides now? Can anyone confirm that the slides are on?
Okay. I can see it.
Okay, fine. So this is about Prologue and data, and first of all, you have seen a number of faces of Prologue. So people sell it as programming and logic, which is only one face, one way you can look at the Prologue system. Another way is you can do things like rule-based systems. You can actually do more or less imperative programming because you can just dictate the entire order in which things happen. So you can do real programming in the classical sense. You can do pattern matching. Let's say parsing, that was one of the original intentions of the Prolog language as it was developed by Bob Kowalski and Alan Kalmauer. I think you have seen an introduction to constraint logic programming. The last time I gave a guest lecture with Anna, I was talking mostly about DSL, so domain-specific languages to build in Prolog. That's also a quite important area. There are lots and lots of other things, but what I want to talk about in this lecture is mostly databases and more or less deductive databases, so databases that reason. Data also has a lot of different ways to look at it. So the most classical one, of course, is to look at them as tables in an SQL database or relational database. More recent view is the graph view, which is as let's say lead paradigm the RDF language. There are a lot of other relational formats. Then you have a number of hierarchical formats. Let's say XML is the most typical thing, where you have a document that have subdocuments and subdocuments, etc., etc. And JSON is a simple, and JSON and YAML are rationalizations of that that are more directed to communicating between computers. We have frame and object-oriented databases, and we have probably a lot more, even many more than I can tell. So what's the role of Prologue in these things? Well, first of all, we have the notion that the model that Prologue uses is completely relational. And that's a very nice fit with especially relational databases, which are still the dominant way of looking into data. But Prologue can also quite easily deal with hierarchical data, both as any system can do by flattening it into relational data. That's one possibility. But you can also do it in by actually representing the hierarchy and walking the hierarchy as a set of pointers, basically by walking structural terms up and down, very much like you would do if you would represent it in an object-oriented system. One of the nice things of Prologue is that it doesn't have this famous object-oriented relational impedance mismatch. So the fact that in the end, if you have to talk from classical languages to a database, it always is always very, very clumsy. while in Prolog a table is simply a predicate. It's a very easy way to look at it. If you want to access this data, you have a number of options. So one of the options is to use we have someone more. One of the options is to use an adapter. So one of them that's distributed with SWI Prolog is the RDBC interface, and that allows you to access an external database just as a predicate. So you can have an SQL query, and you can see it as a logical predicate, basically, and reasonable with it, and include it in other inference steps. One of the others is Sparkle. It's something similar to SQL, but then for RDF graph language. So you can either represent the entire RDF graph in Prolog, and Prolog actually has its own libraries for dealing with that, or you can use talk to an external service that's in using Sparkle instead of SQL. What you can also do is you can just load the data into Prolog predicates. So you have a lot of external data, and you just write import filters that will load this data into the Prolog memory as a number of predicates, and then reason with it. And what we will also see is that an attractive way to deal with this is to look at hybrid solutions. So solutions where you have a little bit of the data in Prolog memory for caching, and mostly for schema, for dealing with the schema of the database, and the real massive amount of instances you leave in some database. If you look at Prolog and for querying data, it's really very very simple, because a join in database is not that much more than just a conjunction in Prolog. So it's a very simple way of looking at these things. Filters that you can apply to databases are just predicates that put additional constraints on the answer that you generate. And functions are just predicates where you have input and output arguments, and you go on with the output arguments. And Prolog has a number of libraries for dealing with aggregation, which is another important part of traditional databases. So we have the classical, which you probably have heard about, is predicates like find all and back off. But you also have a more extensive library aggregate where you can sum answers from a query and do all kind of other operations with answers from a query. And you have solution sequences where you can use to do things like reordering the answers of a query or limiting to the first a certain number, or forgetting about the first certain number, so doing an offset calculation, those kind of things. But one of the nicest things about Prolog, if you work with data, is that you can build small queries from bigger ones, or bigger queries from smaller ones. So if you work with SQL, you have these giant SQL queries that are fed to the database, and if you can't really reuse them in any sensible way, you have to make a new one that's basically copy and paste and edit from the old one. While in Prolog, you can make very small queries and just combine them together with it to make more interesting queries. So you can explore the data in a much more natural way. There's a link in this which you have been working with Swiss quite a bit, and maybe you have actually looked at this example. This is the let's say database example that's in Swiss, but there's a very simple movie database, and you can do some interesting queries. Of course, that's basically just toy, nothing more. So how does it work using in practice? So one of my oldest commercial users is a company called Securities, that's based in New Zealand, and they're using Prolog for basically implying business rules in the area of stock market transactions. And all that stuff, all that data is stored in SQL databases, and they use Prolog to combine all these transactions and apply and enforce business rules on all this data. And to do that in a nice way, they actually developed a language called CQL, Constraint Query Language, it's an abbreviation for. And that's a high level language written using Prolog syntax, so it's actually a Prolog thing. It's a Prolog domain specific language. And that allows them to express queries on all these databases at a very high level in such a way that they can also reuse the smaller queries into bigger queries. And their entire business model is based on Prolog dealing with large amounts of data in external databases. They started actually, this is a nice story, they started writing this program originally in Java. And then they thought they needed a little small Prolog engine to do some of the reasoning, some of the rule reasoning. So they integrated Prolog they had a hybrid architecture of Java and Prolog and external databases. And Prolog was doing the rule-based reasoning in this thing. And I'm afraid I couldn't find it anymore, but once I got a nice picture about the involvement of the amount of code in the company. And it was the Java code was kind of steadily falling down, and the Prolog code was steadily climbing up. Originally it was kind of 90% Java and 10% Prolog, and now it's just the other way around. I used Java still for a couple of connections to the outside world, but that's it. All the rest of the applications written in Prolog now. So that's all very good news, of course, but that also has some problems. You have had the theory of SQL of SLD resolution, and you know that one of the biggest problems is you can easily write expressions that are logically correct but do not finish. Or so the classical one is that if we have connections, let's say in a railway system, that we could write a transitive closure of all these connections simply as connection connected X or XZ. Connected X to a Y, and then the connection between Y to the Z. That's a very nice way of writing it down, and then you have a lot of connected facts that one city is connected to another city, etc., etc. But if you try to run this in Prolog, it will never terminate. So it's logically correct, but it won't run. Another big problem is that if you write a conjunction, so basically a join, it matters a lot in which order you write it. So if you have a SQL, if you have a proper SQL database, it doesn't really matter how you write all the joins. It should in theory come up with the same problem, with the same query plan, and get the same efficiency. In practice, that's not always the case, but in theory, that should be the case. In Prolog, the order in which the conjunction is evaluated is simply left to right, and it doesn't do any planning in this thing. That allows us to reason about the order in which it does things, but it doesn't allow Prolog to do something fast. You have to tell Prolog the right order in which to solve these queries to get the fastest answer. You have to think about that yourself. Another one is the rather poor handling of negation, which makes more complex logical expressions simply evaluate very either have semantically very poor results and possibly also be very very slow. So Prolog is not really a truly declarative language like what SQL in theory should be, at least the original SQL. So what do we do? One of the solutions is to do programming. And as we said, as we've seen in Prolog, we can control the order in which things are done and control the search space using cuts and other non-logical operations. So we can use all kind of techniques to write a program that's still the same original logical program, but evaluates a lot faster and scales a lot better, and deals with things like cycles, for example, in your data and all these kind of things. The techniques are stratification. So to if we go to the railway network, you start with a connection from A to B, and then you know if you can go from A to B, you can also go from B to A. So you can a rule that says that if you can go from in the one direction, you can also go in the other direction, but that's a separate level. And then you have the next level where you do the transitive closure, where you watch out for cycles. You can, if you do a complex join, you can think about the ordering of the joins. So you make you put the most selective ones first, and you limit the search space. In some cases, it's also possible to materialize a relation. So you have a predicate that's actually you want to use from in the opposite direction, and where it easily computes. What you do is you you just materialize the entire relation, so you can also query it in the other direction. But you have to do all that by yourself. Well, if you have a proper database, the database will actually do that for you. It will look at your query and look at the data it has and says, okay, if I do this first and then I do that and I use this technique, then I get the proper result. Probably doesn't do that for you. Another solution to this problem is to use Datalog. I don't know how many people have heard about Datalog. So Datalog is a language that's also conceived somewhere in the late 80s, I think. Yes, thank you. Datalog is a language that restricts. It's basically a sub-language of Prolog, so it uses the same syntax roughly, but it doesn't allow a lot of things that that Prolog can and it does allow you to do. It also does not provide operators like the cut and assert and retract and all these kind of things that that make, let's say, the non-logical part of Prolog. What it does perform is what it does, and it also works in a different way. So Prolog typically works top down, so goal directed. So you start with the original goal that you want to prove, and then you work top down to the facts. Datalog works the other way around, so it has facts and rules, and it will do bottom up evaluation to find new facts from given the known facts and the rules that it has. And it doesn't do that in the completely stupid way, because then it would have to compute everything that's possible. And there's an algorithm which is called the magic set algorithm, which kind of only does the bottom-up evaluation in those parts where it actually is quite likely to contribute to the final answer. So it doesn't compute everything. And the nice thing about Datalog is it's fully declarative, and it's also sound, logically sound within the restricted language that it is. So it's not a full-blown programming language, but it is a fully declarative language where you can do reasoning at very big, a large scale. One of the disadvantages, so it's not Turing complete. So it's really not a programming language, it's a database. What I will speak a little bit more about is the work on tabling, which is, so we have the SLD resolution that you know about, but there's also another resolution technique for the same Prolog problem that we have, which is called SLG resolution. SLG resolution basically gives you the same declarative properties as Datalog gives you, except that you are also not allowed to use everything that's in available in Prolog. So you can, for example, also the use of cuts is very limited. The use of assert and retract is very easy. Is also not possible in the tabling engine. But you can use a number of things, like for example function symbols, so compound terms in tabled logic programming, tabled Prolog. So the basic idea of tabling, and that's why it's called tabling, is that it basically stores all the answers that the query produces in a table. So if you have a particular query, it will just enumerate all the answers and put all the answers in a table. And if you next ask the same query again, it will just reuse the answers from the same table. One of the effects of that is it reduces the impact of non-optimal ordering. So if you have if you do the ordering wrong of a goal, you might have a very bad performance, because evaluating the second will fail, and then the first will come with something that's actually the same as that it came up with before. Then the second will again do its expensive work, and so you get a lot of expensive work being done. And using tabling, that is not the case anymore, because the table already knows the answers, and the second goal can immediately simply give the right answer. I see a question here. Does the Datalog also support stratification and ordering? Datalog doesn't need that, because you need for solving these hierarchical this stress disclosure, for example, if you do the bottom up and you do the bottom up until you have no more new additional answers anymore, you never go into a cycle. So if you just look at in using the restrictions of data log, if you get the facts and get the rules and just keep applying the rules until there's no rule that applies anymore that produces anything new, you're guaranteed to terminate. And stratification is not needed in that case. Does that answer the question? Thanks. So the second idea of tabling, so the first idea is you just store everything that's there. And the second idea is to delay everything you can't solve now. And that's actually the thing that makes tabling very interesting, because it basically gives you an automatic way of stratifying your program. So suppose we have this famous case of self-recursion connected. And you have a fact connected Amsterdam Leiden, we are still in Holland. And you have a query that says connected Amsterdam to The Hague. So what will happen is that we'll be go into our rule. The first rule will say, okay, I am connected. Amsterdam is connected to The Hague. If Amsterdam is connected to something else, which I don't know, so I need to solve that query. So I go back to the first rule and I come with exactly the same query that I started with, because I have connected Amsterdam to something. And then if I reuse the first rule with connected Amsterdam to something, I have exactly the same query. So that's never going to work. At that moment, I know that if I continue like that in the prolog way, I get into a cycle. What tabled logic programming does, it knows about all the goals that are not yet fully in the table. In this case, it starts with connected Amsterdam to something. Then it sees again Amsterdam to something before Amsterdam to something is finished, and then what it will do, it will delay this thing. So it will just say, I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to save the state of the execution of connected to Amsterdam to something and know what I have to do afterwards to get to an answer, but just otherwise save the execution and start doing something else. So then it comes with Amsterdam connected to Leiden. Then it gets back to the saved execution and say, okay, Amsterdam is connected to Leiden. And then it goes on with the last connected YZ, etc., until it finally finds the answer. So what happens in the end is that it changes the original top-down query into basically a bottom-up query evaluation at the moment that it does the tabling resolution. And that allows it to get the same kind of declarative properties as data log gets. The other very interesting one is how it deals with negation. So if you have a table, and the table has already, you have a table that belongs to a certain query, and that query is negated, if the table already has an answer, you know, well, the negation is false, because there is an answer to this query. But also, if the table is complete, so you have all the answers, you know that you have all the answers to this table, and it's still empty, you know that the negation must be true, because there's no answer. If you've never seen the query that you want to negate before, you just try to solve it and try to make to build up a table. And then you might end up that while trying to solve the negation, you get into the same negation. So you get a loop over through the negation itself. And what happens then, it will again say, I don't know what to do, so it will delay the execution. And then if all is done, it will either end up with something that it can solve by stratifying the entire problem, because now it has an explicit state of the entire problem. Or it can use an algorithm which is called well-founded semantics to figure out a free-valued logic. So one where things are true, ones where things are false, and ones are things where we don't know. And I have an example of that, which is available on Swiss as well, with that does tabling. So this is the well-known Russell's paradox. So we have people that we live in a town where people shave each other or themselves. And we have rules that say that the barber shaves someone, saves any possible person that does not save himself. And we have two facts. We have one person that's the barber and one person that's the major of the town. And then we start to solve that and we give the two prologue. Prologue itself, if you do this in native prologue, it will never work. It will simply easily loop through the save recursive calls or through the save and never finish. If we give that to table prologue, which is make sure that we do that by saying table saved two. Then what happens is that it will first of all get to the first answer is rather tricky, so it tries to solve whether the barber shaves himself, but then it gets into a problem, because on the one hand that's true and on the other hand that's not true, and it comes up with what it calls the residual problem that says that the barber shaves the barber if it's not true that the barber shaves the barber. So that's basically just a conflict that can't be further resolved, and the answer is undefined. And it comes with another true answer, that is that the barber shaves the major, because that's clear, there's no problem at all about that that fact. But that's the Anna asked to define stratification. Stratification is a technique that says that separates the problem. So originally we have this problem like connected all in one place. So we have connected two cities, and then we have connected X to Y if connected Y to X. Then we have the transitive closure of the connection. And if we put that all in one predicate, it goes wrong, as we have seen. But if we put it in three different layers of predicate, it goes right. So the first layer of the predicates is just the elementary relation. The second layer of predicate is the one where you turn around the relation. This works because that only gives twice the number of answers, but that doesn't really go looping. And then we put the transitive closure on top of that, and that works again, as long as there are no cycles in the actual network. If there are cycles in the actual network, which is the case for a railroad network, you have to keep track on where you have been so you can avoid getting into a cycle. So if you look at data log versus table prolog, they're both actually fully declarative languages, but table prolog is only fully declarative in a subset of the prolog language. That subset is a superset of data log, but it's still a subset of prolog. Data log, by being fully knowing that it can do whatever it wants to do with the facts that are in this database, can typically do a bit more work on optimizing join operations. And prolog is a little bit more limited in that sense, because of the parts of the language that are still covered by tabling, but are not purely fully declarative in that sense. Prolog is still Turing complete, while datalog is not. So it means that if you want to write a complete application in datalog, you can't do that. You need a second language to make the thing talk to the world and make it actually do something, while in Prolog you can code your entire application. So how does it scale? And these days modern Prolog systems can easily handle tens of millions of clauses in a database. Even things like 100 million is not really not really strange, although you need a machine with a couple of hundred of megabytes of gigabytes of memory in that case. It also does a lot of, especially modern systems, do a lot of indexing of clauses. So indexing, of course, extremely trivial, important if you do this kind of reasoning at these amounts of clauses. But as the YProlog and YAP and a couple of other systems have automatic indexing, so if they see a query, they will automatically try to see, do I have a reasonable index? If I don't have a reasonable index, and then it will automatically create an index on the fly and try to use that. One of the most impressive systems on using Prolog as a deductive database is probably Ergo, also called implementing a system called RuLog. And here are pointers to our slides. This system is not written in SWI Prolog, it's written in XFB. And I have a little talk about that, because at that moment, the last year, I've been mostly working together with XFB, sponsored by a company called Kindy in California, to bring a lot of the XFB technology on tabling, which were one of the were not really the pioneer on tabling, but they definitely managed to get tabling to a very high level, and mostly in the semantic sense, so to be able to do reasoning like well-founded semantics and all these kind of things. That's really the work of David Warren and Teresa Swift at XFB. One of the things that one of the three things that we have been doing in the past years is incremental tabling. So that means that you have a number of tables that are related, and if one of the tables one of the facts that have been the input to a table changes, then automatically the dependent tables will be invalidated and recomputed lazily if necessary. So you get a network of that really performs truth maintenance in the system. Another one is a new visitor. Another one we are working on is called shared tabling. That's something that XFB never managed to get working, but SWI Prolog has pretty good multi-threading, and that allows us to share tables between multiple threads and speed up the and allow them to reuse the results that other threads have already been computing. One of the other things we have been working on, which is a bit the thing that Benjamin Drossoff, who wrote the slides that I was just referring to, is very proud of, is the idea of restraints. So what it does this is that for all these things that are too expensive to compute at the moment, you can say I'm not going to compute them, but give them the well-founded semantic notion of undefined. So I don't know what it is. But then, given the way that table prolog works, it means you can derive for all the other things whether they are true, false, or also undefined as a consequence of this one being undefined. So you can do a kind of anytime reasoning where you can say, okay, I don't know that, but then I still know all these things. And on the other hand, if you're not happy with that, you can go into the things that from the bottom up, but you didn't know, and try to compute them and see what the consequences of that, the new things that you now know in that case. So you can delay things that you don't want to compute at this moment because they're simply too expensive. Another question that sometimes asks is whether prolog databases are ACID. I always forget the exact abbreviation of this thing. But no, in general, the prolog database typically does not have isolation in the sense of transactions and isolation, and it does not have guaranteed sustainability of the data typically yet. Atomic, consistent, isolation, and durable. Yes, thank you, Anne. We do have a little library which is called Persistency that allows you to keep a journal of certain predicates on the file system, and that's reliable in the sense that if you asserted something and this call returned, then it's given the flushing of the file system is actually there, and you can replay the journal and get the data back. And transactions to a certain extent exist in SWI Prolog, but they're not really, they're only used internally for basically for incremental updating of the program while it's running. Another interesting part is how to actually make hybrid databases. Probably one of the more interesting developments in that is TerminusDB. That's a database that's built, that's a graph database basically. It's built on a technique called header dictionary triples to store RDF data, and that's a file-based based system. And then they use SWI Prolog for doing basically the reasoning about the scheme of the database, but also reasoning about whether the schema is complete and consistent, whether it, the instances that that exist are actually in accordance with the schema. And they use Prolog for doing query planning, but also to actually run the web service itself. So this is a nice example of a modern new development that has been started in a European research project and is now being commercialized to a graph database that uses a hybrid technique of file storage and Prolog to achieve a dynamic database in a way where it profits from the reasoning, from the Prolog reasoning about the schema and the query planning. One of the other little things I want to talk about is web access. You have seen Swish. With Swish, we also give it another data name sometimes, which is called Data Lab. Because if you put a lot of data inside Swish, you can actually have a kind of environment where multiple people can work on the same data and exchange data and exchange programs about this data. And once you have done that, and once you have all these little programs stored in Swish, you can actually execute them. You can use this as an API from the external world and let these programs reason about the data from external applications, both in shell, so simply using curl, or there's the Java script interface to Swish, and then there's a Python, Java, Ruby, and Erlang binding these days. Swish can also do a lot of the presentation work for you, so it can represent results using charts and graphs and all these kind of things. And it can also connect to R, which we did for the Data Lab integration, where you basically use Prolog to look at a lot of data and provide views on the data that allows you to explore those things that you're really interested in. And once you have a nice table, you put that table into R, and then you do all the statistics that you want to do on this table. So this is a small thing that shows maybe you have found it. This is a statistics part of Swish, that shows a chart where you see how many users there are logged in at a certain moment. And this is a period of a week. This is a site that's running in Italy. It's a very interesting site, CPLint, and there's a lot of machine learning on top of Prolog and combining that with R. So that shows, not really for data usage, but for another use case, how you can integrate R programs with Swish. This is a really interesting site because there's a lot of machine learning that's available for Prolog. So there's a couple of things I want to kind of say as a take-home message. I think my view is that Prolog is a really good tool for complex reasoning over, let's say, medium-sized data. So if we go to really huge data sets, the kind of things that the social media companies are working with, Prolog is not going to work that well for you, because it can't really deal with that amount of data. But it can deal pretty good with things about which you need quite a bit of rules, and it has sizes of, let's say, a couple of million up to some tens of millions of rows of data, which is still quite a sizable amount. And there are two other ways in the ends on this spectrum. And one end is the end where you have really complex combinatorial problems over a relatively small amount of data. If you are in that sense, you should not be using Prolog, but you can probably better go to a language like ASP on ASP programming. You should look it up to find some details. If you have a really huge amount of data, but you want to do fairly simple stuff on it, then classical RDMS systems are simply much more appropriate to use than Prolog. But one of the nice things about, so in that sense, Prolog is a kind of in the middle. It's something for medium-sized databases. One of the nice things about Prolog is that, unlike ASP program or SQL, it's a general-purpose language. So if you have a complete application that typically imply does more than just the data querying the data, then Parallel can do both the reasoning for the over the data, but it can also do the binding to web pages or and let's say the procedural step to combine the various reasoning steps in the system. This was what I wanted to talk. So about to say. So I give the floor to someone who wants to ask questions. I'll first unshare this one. Have a question here for yes. Let me have a look. Dan says, how much of Free Prolog is written in Prolog? I don't really have the exact numbers. I think I can quite easily do that, compute that for you. Yeah, so that's 123,000 lines of the code is in Prolog. For that's the entire environment, by the way. If you do the same for, and there's about 1 million lines of C in total. So most of Prolog is actually written in C. That's a fair conclusion. And some system can, yes, Anna. That's Anna asked whether that's. Oh, you can read the question, of course. Yes, that's including the packages. So the entire development system and everything combined with that. If you do that a little bit different, so the number, the source code of the C source code of the core is 170,000 lines. And let's have a look. And there's about 100,000 lines of Prolog. Wender asked for my work at Kindy. Well, Kindy. I don't do, let's say, work on the work that Kindy is doing. What I'm doing for Kindy is developing the Prolog environment in such a way that they want to use it. So Benjamin Grossoff is their technical, let's say, scientific director, and he basically steers this project. And at the moment, that's mostly going into extending the tabling facilities of SWI Prolog. In a little bit before that, it was mostly targeted towards improving the deployment possibilities of SWI Prolog. Anyone else? So what is stopping it from scaling to bigger databases? There are a few things. First of all, Prolog is fully in memory, and there have been a couple of Prolog systems that in the past, I think by IBM, that used in part storage on disk, but that never got really popular. I don't know really how well it would work, but I think it's rather complicated to make really efficient. The second thing is that the way that the indexing works, which is basically just mostly a matter of hash tables, is not that good in a number of join operations. So it works pretty well if you have a combination of selective joins and not that selective joins, then it works pretty much okay. But at the moment that you have to join two sets that are both enormous and the intersection is rather small, then the enumerating the one and looking up the result every time in the second set using hash table lookup is rather small, rather slow. there are a number of places where databases can do a better job because they have to merge to ordered set and then they do merging on the set, or they do things with bitmaps. And in theory, that's to a certain extent possible in Prolog, but I'm not aware of people actually doing that. Is it hard to make it work in a distributed environment? We will cover distributed Prolog. well, what shall I say about it? Yes and no, in the sense that there's not that much done in, so you can easily combine Prolog with all kind of external distributing stuff. That's not really a big problem, but Prolog itself has not really a big reputation in itself dealing with distributed computing. But it can do, of course, all the networking stuff. It can do the threading stuff, and so it can talk to other services in a network architecture. Hi Ben. Yeah, SWE is the name of the department where I started this Prolog system in the late 80s. And I had the Prolog system, so it had to be called something Prolog. And so SWE was the name of the department, and it got called SWE Prolog. And SWI actually stands for Social Science Informatics. It was actually a rather strange department of the University of Amsterdam. But a very nice department, by the way. I think Anna dropped out or left. Anyone else? If there are no more questions, then I wish everyone a good evening or morning. That depends on where you are, I guess. And thanks for the attention. And if you have any questions, you can ask them through Anna, or you can go to the Discord forum of SWI Prolog and get involved in whatever you want to get involved in. So thank you all for the attention, and see you maybe in the other fora, and otherwise. Hopefully in Anna's advanced course, and where you will learn more about the ways to distribute computation as one of the subjects I understand. Okay, I'm going to close this meeting now. Thanks very much.